Umami is a New York-based venture-backed startup. My co-founder and I, Brian Slavin, and the team more generally have spent most of our careers working against this promise of interactivity around television. A big part of that focus has been on how to drive those bits, drive that interactivity through the existing distribution channels. That's complicated, not just technically, but economically. It requires a lot of coordination between programmers and show producers and the cable operators. And it's gone very slowly for all of us in the business. We observed that the advent of smart web-connected devices in the living room afforded a brand new path to delivering that interactivity, one that removed most of the technical obstacles to plumbing that interactivity and also set up new economics. It afforded an opportunity for, say, a programmer, independent of how they're delivering their programming, to deliver that interactivity. So we built Umami to basically create a platform where that interactivity could be planned and scheduled and delivered. And there's really two parts to what we're doing. One is we do have a direct-facing app. We're launching on the iPad, and the app's part of a whole big back-end platform. And the app is a place where consumers can go and get great complimentary information about really anything they watch. And then we have a back-end publishing platform. We're really trying to solve two basic problems. One is give consumers a place that's fun, familiar, answers key questions they have about the programming or the advertising they're watching. And then the other problem we're trying to solve is how do you make this work for programmers? How do you cause programmers to want to publish to this platform? How do you take a key source of friction for them out of it? You see in the market today everything from, fairly lightweight check-in or conversational type apps to networks having apps that are not synchronous really at all. They're sort of evergreen apps that you use, they're trying to hedge and give you an experience that works when you're watching them, but mostly when you're not. We're squarely in the last bucket. We think it's really important, not just from a consumer experience perspective, but also from a business model perspective, that our app and that companion viewing experiences more generally have a high awareness of what's on screen. Because when you do that, what you're showing to the viewer is highly relevant, highly engaging, and some of the other economic opportunities like product placement and advertising require that level of contextual sensitivity. We have a data center, and we're listening on a 24/7 basis to broadcasts on all broadcasts and all top cable networks. And using our own proprietary fingerprinting technique, which is basically a way of extracting, key features out of the audio track specifically, we're developing these signatures on a real-time basis. We operate a cloud-based service that the iPad app that we've developed talks to in real time. The iPad's using the microphone and producing the same signatures. And in a matter of literally hundreds of milliseconds, we basically take what we're hearing on the iPad, compare it against our big database in the cloud, and figure out not just what you're watching, but where you are in it. There's a whole spectrum of content that we surface in the app, and it depends a lot on what kind of show it is and whether we're working with the network or not. But right out of the gate, the app, the first thing it does is it figures out what you're on, and it brings to you everything about the show, the cast, the episodes, all the social conversation occurring around the show. And you don't really need to do anything at that point. We'll put content in front of you, and if we have scene-level content, we'll put that in front of you. At the moment that you want to engage, you want more information on that actor, you want to go find a place to go buy that music clip. You're engaged and you're interacting with the app, and if you lean back and stop interacting, the app, it goes back into a passive mode and continues to show you complimentary stuff on screen. So it's absolutely an interactive experience, but it's one where we try to not require your ongoing interactivity. We want to have relevant stuff there for you so that you have an opportunity but not a, but are not required to interact.
What are the business opportunities for you guys and potentially working with networks or, or advertisers or brands, or what opportunities do you see?
In the short term, as a venture-backed startup and for, you know, what's still an emerging consumer behavior, we're really focused on nailing engagement. You know, what kind of content do we need to put there for the consumer to want to open the app and habituate on it? And how do we make it dirt simple for a network to put content there? And how do we learn and pivot and make that that experience rich? We think if we do that well, then we enable the networks to ultimately turn around and sell what they sell better. If we're creating the case for consumers to be hanging out in Umami while they're watching a TV show, then we create lots of natural upsell opportunities for the networks and their clients.